exciting to watch. Genoa, yeah, like we haven't seen him play, so it would be cool to see what he brought to the tournament and how he can pilot those decks. But also Lifeguard, it's always a pleasure to watch Lifeguard play, patrons especially.
Absolutely. The players are almost ready. There was a handshake, and one of them is going to BlizzCon. I'm really excited, as Frodo mentioned, really excited lineups. Anti-Hoi lineup, and Hoi is bringing his trusty Druid, Hunter, and Paladin. What do you guys think about it?
We haven't seen the Paladin yet. I'm still waiting to see if it's Mysterious Challenger or the mid-range one.
What if it's Dragon Paladin?
Knocks you off your seat right now.
Dude.
Pretty unlikely. Almost as likely as his Murloc Paladin. Actually, it's more likely to be Murloc Paladin than Dragon Paladins, based off the way things go. But I want to see what's going to happen. Specifically, can a non-Warrior player make it to BlizzCon? We've seen it go through the top 40. We've seen a few players do it. Mm-hmm. But can Hoi be the first to do it without the aid of Garrosh? Thank you very much, Nim, for the introduction. We're going to go into game number one with Druid versus the Warrior one more time between these two players to see who's going to be able to get that first edge in the series.
Yep, that's a fair matchup to start things off with. Let's see what kind of starting hands they end up with. Hoi, no Wild Card, no Inner Wave just yet in sight.
Nope, and well, even if he had the Inner Wave, do you feel like he'd play on the Shade that first turn, or would he hold on to it, given that he has more mid-range minions?
It's possible that he would have just went for it. But obviously it's not perfect when you don't have the Wild Crow to follow it up. With a clunky hand, you usually wanna save the Innervate and try to find the perfect moment for it.
Well, Darnassus has sprint on curve. However, it's a little bit optimistic to assume it'll survive. There's almost there's so many ways for it to be able to get killed. Whether your opponent can buff the acolyte or buff the armorsmith, use a weapon, use a removal spell,
slam cruel taskmaster, fiery war axe. All of those cards to deal with it quite easily. But well, what's the point of holding on to it really?
Nothing really when you want to ramp specifically into some of these mid-range minions. But hesitation does give you the perception that you have options, and Auskaka might consider it. It's like, well, if he waited this long to play Darnassus, maybe he has a Wild Growth.
Right.
And like, maybe if he has Wild Growth, I don't have to account for one of those cards in his hand. He's like, well, that last card you're holding isn't swipe, it has to be Wild Growth. Like, these kinds of things that are going through the minds of opponents.
I think that the Wild Growth would have come out here over the Aspirant every single time, but it does kind of fake Innervate, maybe.
Yeah, that's also too. Well, I think Auskaka, he's feeling pretty good. I think coining out the Armorsmith is also one of those things that, speaking of Wild Growth.
Oh, wow, there it is. One turn late. He would have loved to have that last turn. No, he's probably just going to go with the Shade. He could ramp up to the low tip, but I mean, you don't want to wait with the Shade any longer. Ooh, that spite.
That spite's pretty big, although I suppose he just wants to try to develop some of his card draw. The challenge is that the Acolyte of Pain, this is the turn where the Keeper of the Grove comes down. And you're always afraid of Acolyte just getting no cards.
Yeah, sometimes it's a strategy where you can kind of line up the Acolyte in a way that you drop it when the opponent, Druid, is about to hit 5 mana, because Druid does not want to play a Keeper with 5 mana. There's so many strong minions for turn 5, Azure Drake, Druid of the Claws, that type of thing. So I think he might lean towards the Dreadcurse here and Hero Power here over the Acolyte. But I wouldn't like hate the Acolyte. I don't think it's a bad play, but just how well the Keeper works out. I think the Dreadcurse here is the stronger play.
Yeah, Dreadcurse here does put some board presence as well. Helps you answer whatever's coming out next for 4 mana. You know, Shredder plus Creds, or the Shredder comes out, Dreadcurse might be able to help answer it.
Yep. We can see that the Acolyte looks like it's going to work out better than the Corsair would have, since there's no real good arson to it, and he might be able to slam it next time.
Now we hit a very awkward scenario where maybe Wild Growth is not get played.
Yeah.
You want to deny the draws from this Acolyte. Drawing is one of the key linchpins to this entire deck. If it's not drawing, it's not doing very much.
Yep, as powerful as Wild Growth can be when you play it on turn 2, here, it's just not doing anything at all. He's not finding the time to play it anymore. Whirlwind off the top. He really needs some card draw. He needs some more. He has to slam, so that's an option. But do you really slam here?
The problem with slam is that your follow-up is also pretty interesting in that, you don't kill a minion, but if you use it to kill a minion, you don't draw. And at the same time, you want to be very efficient with your cards. So it is a very interesting position.
Yep, there's some plays here, with, for example, like killing off the Shade with the Fiery War Axe, Equipment the Deaths by playing the Zero Mana Trade Corsair, but that's a bit risky. What if there's a Harrison Jones waiting? What now?
If it goes on your first Death Spite, are you really that sad? I guess it is, because you just don't have that guarantee for card draw.
I mean, if it goes on a double stack Death Spite.
If he whirlwinds, he hypothetically should be able to clear most minions that come out of that Shredder outside of four health minions and Doomsayers.
Right. Doomsayer is not an issue, really. Okay. Well, that's interesting.
So he trades into Armorsmith. Fair enough. Although, I'm always worried about making sure I can protect my Armorsmith to get as much health as possible.
Yeah, that was an interesting play. Oskaka values the Whirlwind extremely highly, because that was a good moment for the Whirlwind, but he really wanted to hold on there.
Right. In fact, the Whirlwind would have guaranteed a board clear.
Yeah.
And he would have still had Armorsmith for
It seemed pretty smooth, but...
Oh, no, it would have died in the Whirlwind. So the Armorsmith would have actually died as well.
Oh, right. In the shade with it. Yeah, right.
Well, Micro Machine happens to challenge perfectly with every turn passing. In this case, Lotheb only denies the slam, which is pretty inconvenient because that would have been a great slam plus Fiery War Axe opportunity.
Absolutely. The Fiery War Axe still strong here. And against the Druid, your win condition is usually the patrons and not the frothing, so no real problem with just playing the frothing here.
All right, well, Hoi does get some pretty good opportunities this turn.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. This might be the turn for Wildcrowth, because he could also swipe that if he does that. But does the Wildcrowth really benefit you anymore?
Not really, because it feels like Dr. Boom's coming down next turn anyways. So having 8 mana doesn't really change much for the next turn. Does it change anything for the following turn outside of put you in potential range of Force of Nature Savage Roar? It's a very unlikely scenario.
Yeah, he doesn't even have one combo piece right now. If he had the combo in his hand, then maybe it would be more tempting to go for the Wildcrowth.
Does he feel like he can get away with Sylvanas as well?
I don't know, it seems so weak, because the Frothing is just going to trade for it on the board, and the Fire War Axe is going to clean up that.
It's true.
Low step, so if there could be potentially an empty board, Emperor coming from Ostaka. It's actually a tough turn. It doesn't look very complicated, but it is.
Shredder. Well, Shredder is more sticky than Sylvanas in terms of one-for-one body trading.
I like it, considering the frothing.
Yeah, in fact, you just care about having minions onto the board to help fight for control, so that way Dr. Boom has a higher impact.
I think that was the best possible turn he could have made. Waiting with the Wildcrowth, he would have to wait another 4 turns, and that's a little bit too much.
Mm-hmm. I think you'd rather have that mana so you can hit more powerful turns as the game goes on. Oskaka picks up Execute, which helps him deal with the board and some of the minions, but does he want to save Execute for later on? Because he evaluated his hand.
He might want to save it for an Ancient of War. This is not really that good of a target for it just yet.
It's true. You do know that he has Ancient of Wars in his deck.
Right. Oh, there's another one, but second. It's still like it only deals 1 damage or 2 damage, depending on what you want to use them.
Yeah. Well, if you part ways with
the Whirlwind here is... Well, it only kills one of the minions, but it just buffed the frothing quite a bit.
Well, okay, so a stable goal to block, so that way... Fair enough, it kills itself.
Yep.
Assuming a Keeper of the Grove doesn't come out here. He's just going to push for damage.
That swipe also kind of works. Ooh, yeah, right. So the Wildcrowthing last turn looks to be working out all right, because now he can both swipe and play the Sylvanas.
Yeah, and the Unstable Goal was played second, so no matter what you do, it's going to kill the Shredder's minion. Okay.
Yeah. It's going to deal 1 to the minion coming from the Shredder.
Because it's going to collide into it. You have to swipe this, you have to bump it. So all you pray is that it's not a 1 health minion coming out of the Shredder.
Captain Sparrow, though, something would be so bad. Or the 4-1. Okay.
No, that's pretty bad. It's okay.
It's pretty bad, but it's okay.
I mean it's okay because he doesn't have the patrons. But if he had the patrons, it'd be pretty bad.
This low on card, so he will be a hero powering quite a bit. So it shouldn't be an issue that the Argent Watchman can only attack after you use your hero power.
Is Oskaka in the lead because... Or sorry, is Hoi in the lead now? Because he's actually got some quality minions versus Oskaka's got primarily spells.
Oh yeah, I mean, Oskaka's hand doesn't do anything right now. He has some removal, but that's it. He needs card draw. If he finds something like the Crim Patron, that's going to turn things around. But as it is, it's possible that Oskaka is just going to top deck 2 Inner Rages and not have anything to do on many turns.
execute on Sylvanas just to try to deal with it preemptively. Also, he's well aware that he could hypothetically die to a combination attack through Force of Nature Savage Roar. And he even kills this as well.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where you can also evaluate, like, maybe I should attack face if I want to draw into cards, but...
It's a weird game. Both players have 18 HP and top decking.
It feels like this happens a lot more often these days, that Druid vs. Patient comes down to a top decking War of Attrition.
Yeah.
Just whoever can outlast the other opponent. Cool Taskmaster helps activate the Execute. He doesn't have to use his Death Spite attack anymore.
It's true.
It's pretty useful, but that means he also... Does he still die to a Force Nature Savage?
He would, yeah. If he doesn't use the Death Spite to clear the Boom Bots, because that would be 14 from the combo and additional 6 from the Boom Bots. But he might still die to combo, even if he uses the Death Spite here, because those Boom Bots might roll 4s on his face. Or 4 and 3, that would still keep him in the combo range.
Yeah, not a very desirable situation, because it's also one of the scenarios where now, even if he draws cards like Battle Rage, at best he can draw 2.
Yeah.
So he's gonna save the cool Taskmaster for...
Wow.
Huh.
Slightly above average.
Yeah,
For Hawaii.
It's still good enough to kill him with Force Nature Savage Roar.
Yep.
So one draw could end it and put him on the lead for the board. Oh, not wrong piece of the combo.
Yeah, so he has 2 pieces of combo, but it's the same piece, and that's not quite as effective as it is with the Force of Nature.
He doesn't have to use it either, because if he hero powers, he puts his opponent down to 12, so if his opponent armors up, he's going to be at 14, so he still has another 14, turn.
Yeah. So he doesn't need to use one of the roars here to push that 2 extra. Doesn't really do anything. It also kind of gives away that he has the last roar in his hand.
Right.
Alright.
Oh man. That is interesting.
It really is. This is going to be such a close finish.
Patron, cool Taskmaster, and an armor up, you think? Here? Because it does give you the armor up ability, but if you don't armor up now, you don't get the chance to armor up again the following turn to get out of combo range.
But you set up lethal for next turn.
Oh, you're right.
Because it's then damage to face there. With one 5 attack patron, 3 attack patron, and the cruel Taskmaster, he can actually hit Hoya's face for 10 here. I think that's too good to pass up, and with that hand, I feel like he might have to go all in here.
Well, he only has 9 mana available, so he can actually play his entire hand.
Oh, you are correct. Yeah, that's right.
So I think he has to play this just by choice of elimination.
Absolutely. I thought he had the mana to cast all of that, but you are correct.
Now, if he picks up Whirlwind Effect again, then maybe he actually does have the lethal next turn, but Hoy is still on the draw to win the game. Or is he?
Well, that's not it. And now it's going to be Ostkaka with a chance, too.
Right, and what's so interesting, too, is Hoy, he could try to play into Force of Nature number 2, because he can't just hero power the face. He actually has to Savage Roar the face.
Wow. You think he's going to do it?
Yeah, I think so. I think he's just going to say...
But,
okay.
He's clearing, because he could have saved it, because if he was to top deck the Force, he could have casted both of the Roars, because the Emperor discounts.
Also, he's worried about the Patreon copies and... Yep. The more, the merrier. Oh, that would have been disastrous.
Yeah.
Wait, isn't that still disastrous? It's 3, 6, 8. No, it's going to be 3 off. But if he didn't, that copied patron would have been lethal.
Wow.
Yeah. Imagine that. So Hoy using the Savage Roar, saving his behind just for one more turn.
Yep. That's. I mean, can you really wait with this? Just going for the Whirlwind Wars and Command. I think the big question is, do you clear off the Emperor or not? I don't really think he can play both of his cards.
What lethal does he gain by having it versus what you lose? I mean, I feel like you're almost all in at this point, too, if you're Ostkaka.
Right.
But if you want to blink, I wouldn't blame him either. Because if you are out of combo range now by doing this.
Not really, because the Emperor sticks to the board, so that's going to be additional damage.
All right. Ostkaka's out of bullets. Does Hoy draw the card he needs?
No, not yet. Will that keep him safe, though? He can heal for 5 with the lore. He can hero power, so he goes up to 9. He does still survive.
Yeah, he survives. And there's a 5-5 body on the board.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, this game has gone from using all their bullets and using all their knives and close-range weapons to their fists to now they're just spitting on each other in, like, a defeat of fatigue. Like, they just actually can't kill each other at this point.
Right. But those guys have so many throws, man. There's so many kind of things that Ostkaka can draw. Death Spite would do it.
Deathspite would do it. He just needs any way to amplify his damage a little bit.
Right.
Is he thinking about Savage Roar to kill the final patron?
Or the Warsong Commander.
Or the Warsong Commander.
Clearing the Warsong Commander would keep him safe from gnomish inventor.
It could be. There's a lot of choices with the Savage Roar. Where's it gonna go? It looks like he marked the Warsong Commander.
Yeah, I agree with this. It seems like there's not that many things that would...
But one weapon could change it all.
Oh, there's the Gnomish Inventor!
Yeah, so if he didn't, clear it...
There are some really tough calls here, but Hoi is trying to do his best. Battle Rage off the top is a huge draw.
Three chances to find an Inner Rage effect or a weapon.
There's an Inner Rage!
And that's going to be able to allow him to seal it. Osaka takes a first game. Barely.
Yeah, that was a close one. Oh my, so many turns where it's just like, I could have top decked the lethal. Osaka could have. Wow, it's just. Doesn't get any closer than that.
Man, what an intense game number one. And that's just the first of the best of five. Very important, though, that Osaka was able to hold based off what he was anticipating. I know a lot of patron players feel like it's very good against Druids. So if the patron didn't win there,
right.
Yeah, he would have been in trouble.
That's a worthy game one. There's so much on the line right now. I hope the entire series is going to be games like this.
Yeah, and, you know, when you go to BlizzCon, you're also not only playing on a big stage in the U.S. and, you know, competing for the World Championships, but it's a lot of money, too.
It is.
That you have to be fighting for. So these guys, you know, they don't have the most popular streams. You know, they're not exactly the most ones out there in terms of marketing and just doing the community events. They really pride themselves on their strong play and their good tournament earnings. So this is also really a big deal with what they could potentially earn in a huge tournament.
Yeah, even here, if they go out, they get that. I believe it's $1,250, right. But the first prize is $10,000.
Yeah, for every win from this point on, you double up. You go from $2,500 to $5,000 to $10,000, and it's like that's a lot.
It is.
To just play some Hearthstone on a weekend, it's not bad.
That's too bad.
Yeah. And with that, we see that Osaka does have the Druid remove, and Hoi still has that Hunter and the Paladin decks. Those are the ones that are really interesting to me. Now that the Warriors out of the way, can we just play the Paladin?
Yeah, just go for it. I want to see it. I mean, even in the previous match, I was just waiting for the Paladin. Maybe now is the time.
But how does it interact with the Dragon Priest? That's a big question.
I think it should be fine. Equality is quite powerful against Dragon Priest. Dragon Priest sometimes has a tough time recovering from that because the Dragon Priest doesn't draw that many cards. Usually they got things like Thought Steals and Dragon Priest might run out of resources.
It's a good point. You know, without Circle of Healing, it's not the mid-range Paladin, first of all, but without the Circle of Healing, you're right. The only way you can mash draw cards is Holy Nova.
Right.
And by doing so, you're very reliant on board position in the first place. Hoi is going with a Paladin, the first that we're seeing of its kind today, and it is the Secrets Paladin.
Yep, looks like it.
But don't tell Osaka.
Nope.
That's right. This deck is really predicated on making sure that you have strong board by a very good curve. On turns 1 through 5, you're hitting minions back-to-back. Mm-hmm. And then on turn 6, you drop the Mysterious Challenger, pull every secret from your deck. Only one of them, actually. Pull one of each secret from your deck, and then from there, firmly control the tempo of the game.
That's the dream, but sometimes you don't get that kind of draw. Sometimes you just draw all of your secrets into your hand, and the Mysterious Challengers are nowhere to be found. It's a little bit like an inconsistent deck for my taste, but it is quite powerful.
Yeah, it suffers from a lot of what, you know, I call the mid-range syndrome in Hearthstone, where you just unfortunately have a very good curve if it works out, but if it doesn't, you're in a really awkward spot a lot of the times. One thing that's also interesting to consider, too, is that a lot of these Paladins have gotten slower over time. They've started, falling away from the Wolf Riders and the Arcane Golems to more slow cards that have big power, like Tyrion and Dr. Boom. I'm leaning towards that. I feel like I haven't seen many aggro Mysterious Challengers in a while.
No, not at all. Wow, that's an incredible hand from Hoi. He's curving out really nicely here, and I would imagine that it's going to be it. He's still having Divine Favors in there. Ostgaka's hand, a little bit slow, getting a Twilight Whelp, one turn too late. He would have loved to play it on turn one. That Wildfire might do a lot of work, but outside of that, seems a bit slow. He might struggle to keep up with Hoi.
One thing that's really interesting, too, about the Dragon Priest is that Ysera is even though it's like a very slow card and it doesn't actually do anything for a while, it does anchor the deck for like Blackwing Corruptor. And because a lot of times if you're holding a lot of the early game dragons to play on curve, like if that was the only dragon he had, well, not only could he play it for value, but Blackwing Corruptor can't get activated. So Dragon Priest, sometimes it's held victim by its own synergies, versus having your Seraph sometimes isn't the worst thing, even though ideally you'd like to have more plays.
Yeah, I'm a huge fan of the design overall, because like, normally you feel bad when you have your Seraph in your early hand, and it's still not great, but it's at least a little bit less bad.
It's tolerable.
Yes, that's one way to put it.
Very much like, Mysterious Challenger arrives now. Yeah. It's a little bit early, but this card is bonkers. Now, if you don't believe me, just watch in a few turns. However, that said, the thing that's also even more important than Mysterious Challenger itself is the fact that the curve is followed. Ozkaka, on the other hand, does have three AoEs. And when you AoE enough the Paladin down, it's very hard for Paladin to climb back unless they have that Divine
Favor. It is. Hoi will need the Divine Favor in this match.
Right.
One way to win is the Mysterious Challenger. If there's no answer to it and it gets the Avenge buff, it gets up to 10-9 or whatever it is after the Competitive Spirit and the Avenge, that can win the game alone. But if the Mysterious Challenger gets dealt with and this board gets AoE down, he will be down to top decking the Divine Favor.
Right. And the thing is, though, a couple of things to consider. First, Ozkaka still doesn't want to take too much damage. I mean, that's a lot of pressure on board. 9 plus the potential of scaling higher with the Secret Keeper. You don't want to be losing a third or maybe more of your health. The second is, how much does he telegraph, right? Like, if he coined Blackwing Corruptors the Shredder, it's like, isn't that a little obvious that he has AoE? So there's a lot of things like, maybe he doesn't want to be too defensive, but he doesn't want to be too obvious. I'm not sure exactly what he's going to choose here.
I kind of like the coin Blackwing Corruptor anyway. The Paladin, the way it works is it can't really slow down it.
Okay.
Rolling over.
Halfway. Well, yeah. It's like, oh, I need to deal with the threat. Oh, you got me. No, he's got like more AoE.
Yeah, it does deal with a lot of stuff, and that means that he will be taking way less damage on the next turn. Oh, Redemption. Not very good right now. He might only be running one.
Actually,
it's possible. So the Mysterious Challenger won't then get money.
If Redemption's not too bad, because based off the way things have spawned and died, if he AoEs again with Holy Nova, the Pilot Shredder should return first.
Oh yeah, you are correct. So Pilot
Shredder.
And
that's huge.
Yeah, it absolutely is.
Also, it's pretty important that Mysterious Challenger has another minion besides itself. Another minion besides itself.
Yep. Might do something.
Ooh. Here we go. Avenge.
Oh, no. Man. Gotta feel.
Yeah.
Feel it for Hoi a little bit here.
And, you know, the Thalnos is a draw. So that helps him get back, but he's still looking for that Divine Favor.
Yeah, he sure is.
The thing is, there's only one, and that's something that this Paladin deck is also... deck is also...
Noble sacrifice, but he won't get it because there's already one up.
Right. Right.
Right. Right. Five HP. He needs to find a way. He needs to find a Shadow of Death. It doesn't even do it though. No, I think it would not be enough. Death. It doesn't even do it though. No, I think it would not be enough.
That Paladin's out of the way, the Druid's out of the way, the series, or sorry, the Warrior's out of the way.
And lock and load. A lot of cool.
Lock and load.
There's a lot of cool. Cards, yeah. But not that many cards that would really like fit in competitive decks, I would say. Unless not the existing ones.
I do believe people tried Bear Trap for a little bit, but. It's just like, you know, and King's Elec also was kind of cool in concept. It's like, well, if. you joust and you win, you draw the minion. That's very good for consistency, but
if you could just they might be in trouble,
but at the same time he can pretty much play whatever minion he draws in the next couple of turns, especially because he's got two innervates. A lot of people look at this and they say, Savitz, I really want a Wild Growth. But is there an argument against it here to try to grab early board?
No, I think you just do it. You're not too worried about that. Just ramping up here, it seems so sweet.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't absolutely hate that it's something like a Innervate Keeper for the Silence, but still, like getting that out early. And the Ancient of Lore that I mentioned.
That's really big, because now on turn four, when he gets that fifth mana crystal, he can innervate that out. And Druid's in a pretty good spot.
Absolutely.
Hmm.
And Hunter Hand looks a bit reactive at the moment.
Yeah, most of the things are very reactive. Unleash the Hounds is, Ironbeak Owl is, Kill Command is. Of course, the reaction is he low on health?
Yeah. The bow seems to be the only not terrible play here out of the options that I had.
Mad Scientist still being able to peck away and do some work is still significant damage. I mean, that's what makes some of these silence targets really difficult to deal with. Sylvanas, Mad Scientist, they still ultimately do some damage.
Absolutely. Innovating into the lore, draws two cards, let's see what he finds. Imperatorism. And a Swipe.
Swipe is pretty big too, considering Snake Trap exists.
And he even has the Innervate Shredder with 6 mana. And that Innervate, he could potentially play both the 4-3 minion and play the Swipe. It's quite powerful.
I wonder if Horish is going to play the Snake Trap here and make it seem like he might have Freezing Trap.
He could, yeah.
And then does Oskaka feel the need to like bounce it back? I mean, to be honest, Ancient of Lore is not really that bad of a thing to rebound, but you don't want to give the charge to the bow.
Yeah, like the bow charge is the main thing about this. You don't mind about returning the lore to your hand, but the bow getting an extra charge, you definitely have to be a little bit worried about it.
So if he is worried, he might just hold on to this Ancient of Lore attack, swipe, and then put out the Shredder? Or do you think Druid of the Claw is enough of a resistance where he can just bait it out?
No, I think the Druid of the Claw is not what you want to do here. It's a tough situation because you have to kind of try to guess what it is. He probably knows the traps that Hoi is playing. Just dropping the Emperor. Wow, how much damage is that with the Druid of the Claw, Roar? If you charge it.
That is 14 plus 8 is 22.
Plus the Swipe Hero Power.
That's 26. You can't hero power as well. You only can do one of those.
Right. Yeah, that's true. Yep. That's true.
So he'll have 26 damage.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a lot. I mean, he still can't kill him, though. Hoi picks up the Houndmaster, but he has no beast synergy at the moment.
He can unleash and hope that one of those survive for next time. It seems kind of clunky.
He can Owl and Kill Command right now.
It's so bad, though, because the Owl, what does it really do? I mean, silences the Emperor, but if you Kill Commanding it anyway.
It sells on It sells on Freezing Trap.
Oh, that's true.
So, like, if you Owl and Kill Command one target, it makes it seem like it really is Freezing Trap, and
nice.
He has to play as if it is Freezing Trap.
This is actually a really small thing, but he can bluff the trap. I think it's important that he Kill Commands that.
Right, yeah. And of course he Kill Commands the cheaper minion.
Yeah.
And his hope now is for rushing for damage. Oskaka does have a counter to the board, though. One of the things about pushing for damage with Freezing Trap is that you have to continue to shove on your opponent's health, but Swipe stops that.
Yep. All right, so I will Battlecry completely wasted there, but he needed the beast for the Kill Commander. It's kind of okay, I suppose.
Yep. And one thing, too, is that if he can take care of the board and things don't get swiped, he has a clear path to the high main.
That is true.
And he already used one Keep with the Grove on that Mad Scientist, which, by the way, has stayed alive this entire time, dealing 8 damage or so. Not bad.
Is he going to charge?
Yeah. He's going to rebound that and realize that he can go for the face completely.
16 damage in his hand, right? I mean, the minions and the Roar combined. So a 9 on board, Roar with the Hero Power, additional 7. So he needs 2 more damage from that, though. In order to threaten Lethal.
Yeah, he could pick up through... You know, if he just gets Force of Nature, that's more than enough.
Oh, he can go Shredder, Wrath the Shredder for the Murloc Blukilla Warrior.
Yeah, or that's a Flametongue Totem.
Mm-hmm. Easy Lethal.
That's really creative stuff. Really creative stuff. Hoi could stop that, though, if he just goes ahead and puts some pressure onto the board. Yep. High main's his best bet by a big margin. That's 2 extra damage.
Yeah.
And that's going to be game number 3 over in Oskaka's book. The Hunter has fallen.
Yep.
Uh-oh, that's going to be a disaster if he can't actually stabilize the series. Oskaka is 1 game away from qualifying for BlizzCon.
The Hunter really struggling here. And Oskaka's lineup seems to be almost designed to just crush the Hunter and nothing else.
At the same time, though, if you ask Koi what he wanted remaining, I'm pretty sure he wanted this matchup with the Hunter as opposed to playing the Priest, wouldn't you say?
I guess.
I mean, ultimately, I feel like the Priest is still really good at dissecting cards, classes like Hunter with Wormrest Agents and Valence Chosen.
Yeah, it's quite powerful.
But Koi does, at the same time, does have a lot of those tempo cards, right? Like Hunter's Mark and really destroy Valence Chosen.
It's definitely a good matchup for the Priest. But both of those are Oskaka really on the driver's seat here.
Absolutely. And it's going to take a very, very good circumstance for Hoi to be able to come back here, but it's still not impossible.
It's not impossible at all.
Right.
Sometimes with that Druid and the Hunter both, if you curve out nicely and your opponent maybe struggles a little bit, the Priest has a lot of reactive cards in it still, and if he draws those early on and can't play them like Shadow over Death in the starting hand, things like that.
Yeah.
And Priest can absolutely self-destruct.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely true. It's just really tough to kind of swallow because, again, this is the decider match to go to BlizzCon, and this is the match that you started off with, and you're up against someone that you respect a lot as a teammate. Both these guys, they haven't been on team for very long with each other. In fact, it was just 2 weeks ago that Na'Vi got announced along with 6-0. 3 great European players, all very dominant on ladder. And even through qualifier processes. But unfortunately, only one can go through. It feels a little unfair, but at the same time, this is kind of what you need to do in order to continue your journey through the road to BlizzCon.
Oh, yeah. The snow teammates here right now. This is like an unfortunate draw for them, but at least one of them is going to be going through. So maybe there's a little bit of... you're going to feel a little bit better. Even though losing is horrible, you're going to feel a little bit better knowing that your teammate at least made it.
All right, well, Hoi's going to put his faith in nature and hopefully can even up this series, but Oskaka feels like he's in a pretty good spot. Twilight Whelp doesn't gain any dragon buffs, but that is a low curve Priest, which is what you're looking for early on.
An excellent hand. Even he kind of needs another dragon so that he could play the Twilight Help. The Wild Pyro with the coin and the shield is an excellent way to deal with a Shade of Naxxramas.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't really... I don't know if you can keep both the Wild Pyro Power Shield and the Twilight Help Worm Restoration. I think he needs to like choose a path here, and I think he's going to go with the dragon.
It's true, although he could keep the Twilight Whelp to buff the Wormrest Agent and then play Pyromancer and then use those two minions for board control.
Mm-hmm. Then he won't have the coin. If he goes down one coin into Wormrest Agent, then he will no longer be able to deal with the Shade.
That's true. But by keeping the Twilight Wilp, then he has the opportunity to draw into like Twilight Guardian and have that be live too, while still having board control early on.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess it depends what his opponent's going to be able to be doing as well in the following turns.
Keeps all four. Wow, and Ostkaka really hoping to get that extra additional dragon so that he can play the 12 on the turn one. Does not find it.
That's true. Yeah. Oh, Coin Pyromancer. The most board control early on, most damage. Forces Hoi to Wrath it or choose to Wild Growth and Ramp.
Yep.
Not to mention that this challenges Darnassus Aspirin. It's very smart.
Oh yeah, we saw like, this exact same situation in one of the earlier Ostkaka's matches where he chose to go for the Wild Pyromancer first. And it makes a lot of sense.
Right. Valen's chosen a pretty good draw too, just to continue to plant the board. Hoi only has the Shade of Nexramus this turn.
If nothing for next turn. Oh my, he really needs to find something that he can play on this turn four.
Dark Cultist as well.
Yep.
Which do you like better? Dark Cultist is a pile of stats. I mean, it's actually more stats than Valen's chosen.
I wouldn't even hesitate. I would just drop the Cultist here. It seems like it's so powerful to get out. And Hoi already struggling to get a full clear on the board.
It's true. I mean, the only thing that Valen's chosen really gives you is the ability to do more damage this turn.
Yeah, it makes the keeper kind of good, though.
That's true. There's two targets that you want to silence.
Right. And he plays the Cultist. Here we go. And Hoi, this is an important draw for him.
Yeah, if you can.
Well, I guess.
Yeah, it kills off the Wormrest Agent and the Pyromancer.
It's not good, but I think the board is just going to get too bad for him if he doesn't play it here.
The Priest can just pick up so many good trades. Pyromancer allows him to get really good sweeps. Yeah, you know, desperate times call for desperate measures. You're not happy about it, but you gotta live with it. And Ostkaka is the one who is going to need to find something to do. The Valen's Chosen allows him to kill this pretty effectively. He's going to want to hold on to Twilight Wilp at the same time.
Starting with the shield, hoping to pick up something else. Shrinkmeister.
Not bad.
Okay.
There is value to holding on to the Shrinkmeister, though.
There is, yeah, because he does play those Cobalt Shadow Priests, for example.
Mm-hmm. But there's still none of them in sight.
Nope.
And the Shrinkmeister, if it comes down now, is three damage onto the board, and then Blackwing Corruptor plus the Shrinkmeister should be able to contest whatever comes out next.
And this is really in line with the way that Ostkaka has been playing this matchup. He likes to put a lot of pressure early on, not holding on to too many of his cards for any sort of weird combos. Like coining out the Wild Pyro early on, not saving it to try burn anything down. Oh, and there's the Cabal. But it would have been a long time off still. He would have had to wait a long time to actually utilize it with the Shrinkmeister.
So the Sylvanas is basically saying, you need to kill off your board right now. But then if he kills off his board, what's he going to Blackwing Corruptor? The face and just be aggressive?
Yeah, I guess. There's not really any other options.
It's like you said, this Priest deck is so reliant on making sure that the board keeps getting snowballed into the tempo of the player controlling it, that you're forced to do these maneuvers, but we've also seen the exact opposite where Drew is like, okay, I handle your aggression, and then win. Like, Tice was in this situation too, where he could just remove.
The late game seems to favor the Druid. I mean, yes, Dragon Priest does have that Ysera. Ysera is a card that Druid really struggles to deal with, because Mulch is not a card that's in the Druid list that we are seeing here. So with that 4-12, drawing those stream cards, it can win the game in late game, but generally the Druid is going to outdraw the Priest.
Well, Hoi does have the Ancient of Lore, but he also can try to remove. Ancient of Lore does act as a body that like, the Priest will have to deal with, but I guess he's worried about how much damage he could take, too.
Yeah, well, I like the Lore here a lot. If he went for something like Swipe, there's nothing more that he can do this turn. There's kind of already a trade that's likely to happen. Also, getting those extra cards makes the Emperor even better for the following turn.
Agreed. Well, now Ostkaka's in a pretty interesting situation here. A lot of people feel like, well, you know, I want to be able to fight for the board and be making sure that I can always have something really firm on it. But at the same time, things like Shadow or Death kind of leads into like Is that all he does that turn?
It's really weak. I mean, he could go Valiant Chosen, but do you want to do that when you know that your opponent has Big Game Hunter in his deck?
Right.
You're committing so hard. We know that playing the Valiant Chosen on the Corruptor would be just fine in this situation, looking at the hands. But if you lost Kaka, you probably don't want to put so many eggs in one basket.
Right, you just kind of just hit and then not actually buff it at all. Which feels counterintuitive, because generally speaking, you know, rules in card games, the more the person uses more mana generally is an advantage. It's a hard decision to make.
It really is. Even the Shadow of War Death is not obvious, because there could be an Ancient of War coming up afterwards.
Right, which you know are in Hoi's deck.
Oh, he's gonna go for it.
Okay.
Oh man, big plays.
Plays for days, 7-8, going to the face, and puts potential lethal with the Holy Nova. Although it's still very iffy, Druid most likely will heal, armor up and get out of that range.
Well, he can kill it with either, Force of Nature.
Wrath?
Wrath, I think that's it, yeah.
Force of Nature Wrath seems reasonable. You have a decent amount of cards.
Or he could also Wrath for one, Wrath for three, and then swipe if he wants to cycle and keep both of his forces. But it seems a bit weird to be holding on to two Force of Natures. Like, you don't really need it more than one.
Yeah, I like using a Force of Nature. It's clunky to use as turns go on.
Yeah, it really is.
Unless you drop Emperor Thorazin, which is very optimistic.
Nostkaka not going to be too sad to see this trade happen. Two cards for two cards, and he had what looked like a bad turn last turn turned out to work quite all right. He keeps the initiative.
That's not what he needed. No. Although, Kamar Shadow Priest is still board presence, but looks like he is getting hit by the Eternal Priest problem, which is finishing the game.
Yeah.
Priest is really good at starting fights, he's just never good at ending them.
Playing the 6 mana Chilwin Yeti. Feels bad, man.
Yeah, it's definitely not what you want, especially when your opponent drops an Emperor Thorazin with a pretty scary hand.
Yep.
Like, scary hand size, excuse me. The hand itself is nothing too special, but it's what it could represent.
Yep. What Otskaka has going for him is that Hoi is already down to 11, and he's going to be able to hit for another 4 here, so he will be able to put Hoi down to 7.
True that. This is his second Shadow War Death, though.
It is.
And if an Ancient of War gets drawn, it's a brand new game.
Yeah, it is. Then at that point, Otskaka will have to get his Vol'jin.
But what else is the alternative? Holy Nova to kill the Thorazin?
No,
way.
He has to do this.
You have to go for it and cross your fingers that there's no Ancient of War.
Absolutely. I mean, with those cards, and he's even going to play the Twilight Vol'jin.
Yeah, I'm down.
It's not going to do anything, it's going to get swiped, but I still kind of approve, because with that hand, what else can you do?
BGH a little late to the party.
Yep.
He RSVP'd as a maybe on Facebook, but got there too late. And now the swipe double clear here is definitely enough. Would you Wrath at all just to draw another? Actually, no, you can play the Pyre Shredder.
Mm-hmm.
Thorazin's so good.
What's the interaction here? Maybe he swipes that first. If he swipes the Cabal Shadow Priest first and then the Dark Cultist, does it actually
No,
die?
It should be fine. I think it's because you kill it simultaneously, it doesn't actually buff.
Right.
I think
there used to be a bug earlier on where the main target damage happened first, where you sometimes like a...
Right.
Like it used to... If you casted it on an Imp Gang boss, it would
kill the 1-1.
Yeah.
Because it triggers the 4 damage first.
The 4 damage first, and then the 1 damage. So if this was still the case, it would have buffed that other minion, but that bug has been fixed, so those two swipes going to get Hoi the full clear.
This is one of the worst feelings in the world. You're so close, but 7 health feels like 70 health.
Yeah, and Priest is not good at closing out games.
It's like he's like, I wish this was Mind Blast.
No. Or Ragnaros, but I don't think he'll put that in his dragon deck. No way. He needs to top deck the Ysera. Maybe get Awakens. That would do it.
Wow. Wrathing for 1 to draw a card.
Yeah.
And he's Wrathing his Big Game Hunter so that Holy Nova doesn't destroy him. I like
That's really smart.
Draws
like
Lotheb off the top. This is a very good situation for Hoi to turn it around.
Twilight Guardian, no.
Yeah, but it doesn't have even taunt. It
doesn't do anything. Yeah, he played the Whelp earlier. It didn't do anything, but that's just not helpful. He needed to use Hera badly.
Now is also scenario where Hoi gets Savage Roar off the top, and that's game. A 3-turn reverse.
What do you think about Cleric and healing the Big Game Hunter?
into
trying to like desperately. Yeah, I mean, just play the cleric and hope to find something nice. Maybe a corruptor or.
That gives you 7 mana. That definitely gives you some room for plays.
Oh, he's still doing it.
I think, you know, desperate times.
All right.
Calls for desperate measures.
I like it.
All right. Well, Hoy has 13 damage. Just needs a little bit more.
Oh,
Savage Horror is ripped.
That is going to do it.
That is a tied series, and we're going to game number 5 to determine who is going to BlizzCon.
Oh man, I'm getting excited for the 5th game. There's so much on the line here.
Unbelievable turnaround. Hoy just breathing a huge sigh of relief because he knew, based off that start with Priest curving out very aggressively, he got the Blackwing Corruptor on turn 5, and you know he was struggling a little bit. He hit the Savage Roar when he needed a drop on turn 5 himself. It was not looking very good for Drew.
Not at all, but it worked out in the end. And now we're going to see if the Priest is that good against Hunter, or how good is it? Because I think that it's quite clear that the reason why the Priest is in there is mostly because of the Hunter that Ostkaka expected from Hoy. So now we just have to see if Ostkaka's counter is going to work like it's supposed to.
Like it's supposed to, but in the end it's not a 100%.
Absolutely not. I mean, we've seen a lot of clunky draws from the Priest. Like having those Novas when they don't do anything, not getting your dragons at the right time. There's a lot of things that can go wrong. There's still so many reactive cards in it.
Yeah, it's very subtle, whether or not you get the right curve, whether or not you get the right synergies.
Yeah.
We saw for a while that Twilight Whelp was not able to be played for a long time.
Yeah, we saw Kabal getting played with Battlecry getting wasted. So many things that just like didn't line up there.
If it actually got that Dragon buff, would that have been relevant? Because it wouldn't die to the swipes very easily.
Yeah, it would have helped.
Yeah,
I believe so.
He would have had to Wrath that instead of Wrath to draw. He wouldn't have had Lothar. I don't know, it's very interesting turn of events, but just something very subtle like that means Ostkaka maybe had extra damage, which means maybe the Hoy Nova was lethal. You never know.
Yeah.
Very interesting, but it all comes down to game number 5, the Hunter versus the Priest. We're saying that we think that the Priest has the advantage, but, you know, we've seen already a couple times today, even if a matchup goes one way, it certainly could go the other way.
Yep. Let's look at the starting hands. Nothing too excited for Ostkaka here. He really wants to find the Twilight Guardian. And maybe the what's it called? The Wormrest Agent?
Yeah, the Wormrest Agents.
The one but Twilight Whelp.
The Twilight Whelps. Valence Chosen's not bad when you have the coin and you have the one drop. So Northshire Cleric is also very good.
And, Wild Pyromancer also, because of the coin, quite good.
So there's around six to eight cards that I think he'd be pretty acceptable to just throw back and
but this
try to
is
get
not
for.
It. The only one that I would even consider keeping here is the Dark Cultist, because you have the coin. So you have the ability to potentially play it on turn 2. But I think with so many one drops or two drops, you just throw everything away and hope to find even better cards than this.
For Hoy, Haunted Creeper makes sense because it's on curve. In fact, the later the game goes, the weaker Haunted Creeper gets by a big margin considering Cabal Shadow Priest.
Absolutely.
So you want to keep that.
But it's also, it's not like the best two-drop ever, because you want to put out a lot of pressure against the Priest. Something like a Knife Juggler would be superior.
Yeah, and in the early game, it actually does tend to favor Priest based on board dominance, but that's only if they curve out very well.
Yep. No, he does
no
keep...
No dragons.
Ostkaka did keep the Dark Cultist, and he also picked up another one. And again, the same situation. No dragons in his hand.
But I mean, two Dark Cultists is kind of like the dream. Like,
it's
no matter,
pretty good.
No matter what, one thing gets buffed, unless he silences it.
And it's really hard for a Hunter to remove as well. Like, the removals, bow deals 3, quickshot deals 3.
That's right.
So you need to throw something more into it to clear it.
Dark Cultist is a hipster. He was a 3-4 before 3-4s were cool.
And it has a cool death rattle effect. It,
yeah.
Just a really powerful card.
Also a badass hood.
Haven't even paid attention to that.
It's a cool character to cosplay for sure. Hoy does have the ability to deal with Dark Cultist, but
so
it's definitely
you,
costly, both card and mana-wise.
Would you deal with it?
What are you afraid of on a following turn 3? There's nothing
I
that can
know.
Taunt. Because the problem with Dark Cult is if you can hide it behind something that can trade very effectively and then give the health buff to. Oh, he tosses in the lot for potentially getting Freezing Trap off the secret.
It could be. But that's a bit weird on the sequencing. He first plays a Creeper and then straight at it. Does he only play Snakes?
No, we saw Freezing Trap in the opening hand.
Right, yeah. So it's snakes and freezing.
All right, well, Oskaka has to consider a lot of things. It also hypothetically could be a third trap that we haven't seen.
It could be, but I think it's almost safe to say that he only plays those two traps. And I would imagine Oskaka just go face here. There's nothing else that he wants to... wants to freeze over the Dark Cultist, really. Oh, he's really, really confident, yeah.
Yeah, the Freezing Trap does end up popping. Yep.
I like, by the way, I like the way that he played the Dark Cultist first, because just in case there was an explosive trap, it would the buff would not have been wasted, and he would have had a 3-5 Cultist instead of the 3-4.
Yeah, it definitely makes sense. Well, historically, this has been the point back when Priest was control, where you played Shadow Madness and made the Hunter cry, but that's not the case here. In fact, most of the spells like that have been cycled out for more minion-based stuff.
Still has a really good play here with the Agent and the Shadowverse Paint. He can paint the Spider and then trade with the Houndmaster. Yeah, the Agent is only going to be a 1-7, but it's still something.
Imagine if it had taunt.
Yeah, that would have been crazy. It would have went from... I mean, 2 attack is really big. It kills Dive Jugglers, it kills Scientists, it kills Creepers.
Yep, even the... Oh, but wow. Well, that's an answer.
That is definitely pretty good.
I guess it didn't matter if it was a 2-8 taunt or 1-7.
But it's still less board. Like, this is not something that he can use Valence Chosen on anymore.
That is
true. Valence Chosen on this is, like, just ridiculous. It's a 3-11?
Yeah.
It's almost Jirax's status.
He might save the Honda Smug here because that's only a 1-2. Okay, never mind. There we go.
I mean, it's a 0 mana, deals 6 damage.
It's, yeah, how do you say no to that?
And his hand is telling him to be very aggressive. Mm-hmm. In a very provocative way.
Oh, like, that's an important dragon. Now the Corruptor is going to kill the Juggler.
That's huge, you're right. Oh my goodness, Blackwing Corruptor shutting down the Knife Juggler, which means the aggression from Hoi once again has been stopped. He needs like high main off the top, but even then it gets challenged. Oh, Iron Beak Owl is not that good.
No.
And also, it's one of those scenarios where you have 2 quick shots, and so you can't live the quick shot dream.
Just doesn't work. Well, he really needs something like a high man here over the Owl. The owl effect, again, not useful at all. What do you even play? You don't want to play any of this.
Is there any room for him to just be aggressive? Just like quick shot phase and try to... try to just go for it. He's going to kill Command.
Yeah.
Alright, well, 3 attack is something, but he's going to get 2/3 of that slashed away by the Cabal Shadow Priest, most likely. Although Twilight Guardian's also reasonable, too.
Cabal Shadow Priest puts a little bit more pressure on the board. Argument could have been made in favor of keeping it for something like a Scientist or a Hunted Creeper later on.
The thing about what Hoi's play last turn did as well is that he's not weaving in things like his hero power, and unfortunately, that does tend to add up if you're trying to race your opponent. However, I think Hoi, by going for a defensive kill command, has also said, I try to want to control the state of the board, but he's in no position to. Priest is in such a good spot.
Yeah.
He picked up a second dragon, so Twilight Guardian will now have taunt. Before, it was just the only dragon in hand.
I think trying to weave in the hero powers and end the game early would be almost hopeless, because he's playing the mid-range hunter after all. There's no charges. It's just against the
there
priest.
Is one.
Oh, there is?
Yeah. The animal companion.
Oh,
How could you forget?
Hoffer, of course.
Yeah.
But still, it's just it doesn't seem like a winning strategy when the priest is still so high on HP, so he's hoping to find his high mains as fast as possible and maybe win the game with those.
Hoi looks defeated. I mean, it's not really a face of a person who's really confident in his chances to go on.
Yeah.
And I think he's really feeling like this was an opportunity to potentially go, but he quick shots the Cabal Shadow Priest, but that usually doesn't mean do much because Priest can heal that minion right back.
Oh, man.
And Oskaka picks up the Holy Nova, which means pretty much he can handle everything. Single targets, he can handle AoE. Even if high main came down, he's got the perfect response of the Shadow Word Death plus the Holy Nova.
Oskaka feeling confident enough to just go offensive.
Oh,
That's a good draw, but it might be too late.
This might be game right here. Oskaka's got the perfect response. We just mentioned it. Shadow or Death, Holy Nova. And we does know that Snake Trap is also in the deck.
Yep.
But that still might make him Shadow or Death attack first and then Holy Nova. We'll see. He might try to activate it as well.
Ooh, seems like he's trying to do it last, not activate the trap.
Oh my goodness, that's so much board dominance, and he's looking at potential killing him in the next few turns. Hoi's going to look at his next card, but it's a web spinner, and that might do it. I think we might have our third finalist for BlizzCon. He's going to quick shot his own web spinner, see what he draws. Yeah. My ex could have maybe changed something, but that's going to do it. Osaka is the third person to represent EU. He is going to BlizzCon.
Yeah, what a series. Wow. We saw all five games there. It's really worth it for a match like this.
Yep, absolute great journey here for Osaka, and an emotional moment for him as well. A person who's trying to prove himself for a long time, over a year and a half. It's been a pleasure to see him qualify. Rachel's waiting with Osaka for a few words.
I am. I'm down here with Osaka, and you are our third qualifier to go all the way to the Hearthstone World Championships at BlizzCon. Let's give it up for Osaka. I actually learned this weekend that your name means cheesecake.
Yeah, it does.
That's delicious and fantastic. So you played all five games in this series, and you had to face your teammate once again. Was this nerve-wracking for you, or was this kind of like the best-case scenario for you?
I mean, it's obviously not the best case scenario if I have to knock out my teammates. Really unfortunate we couldn't practice together before the event and stuff like that. But yeah, I'm really, really happy that I didn't go 0-3 with my new like tech deck versus him. So yeah, I'm glad it pulled out in the end.
There had to be a couple minutes where you were nervous there. I mean, what was the most nerve-wracking moment of this match?
I mean, basically when I was going to lose game four, because I thought I was really ahead in the early game, and then I realized, oh, maybe I'm even going to lose this entire series. So. At the end of game four, that was really, really nervous.
Well, you have a huge crowd here cheering you on. What is it like to play in front of such a large audience who is so into this game?
Well, this morning I was actually extremely nervous, but then now I'm a little bit more comfortable with it, and it's really fun to sort of hear the audience cheering and everything.
I guess you feel pretty at home.
Maybe I should attack face if I want to draw into cards, but...
It's a weird game. Both players have 18 HP and top decking.
It feels like this happens a lot more often these days, that Druid vs. Patient comes down to a top decking war of attrition.
Yeah.
Just whoever can outlast the other opponent. Cool Taskmaster helps activate the execute. He doesn't have to use his Death Spite attack anymore.
It's true.
It's pretty useful, but that means he also... Does he still die to a Force Nature Savage?
He would, yeah. If he doesn't use the Death Spite to clear the Boom Bots, because that would be 14 from the combo and additional 6 from the Boom Bots. But he might still die to combo, even if he uses the Death Spite here, because those Boom Bots might roll 4s on his face. Or 4 and 3, that would still keep him in the combo range.
Yeah, not a very desirable situation, because it's also one of the scenarios where now, even if he draws cards like Battle Rage, at best he can draw 2.
Yeah.
So he's gonna save the cool Taskmaster for...
Wow.
Huh.
Slightly above average.
Yeah,
For Hoi.
But still good enough to kill him with 4 stages right. Average War.
Yep.
So one draw could end it and put him on the lead for the board. Nope, wrong piece of the combo.
Yeah, so he has 2 pieces of combo, but it's the same piece, and that's not quite as effective as it is with the Force of Nature.
He doesn't have to use it either, because if he hero powers, he puts his opponent down to 12, so if his opponent armors up, he's going to be at 14, so he still has another
14,
turn.
Yeah. So he doesn't need to use one of the roars here to push that 2 extra. Doesn't really do anything. It also kind of gives away that he has the last roar in his hand.
Right.
All right.
Oh, man. That is interesting.
It really is. This is going to be such a close finish.
Patron, cool Taskmaster, and an armor up, you think, here? Because it does give you the armor up ability, but if you don't armor up now, you don't get the chance to armor up again the following turn to get out of combo range.
But you set up lethal for next turn.
Oh, you're right.
Because it's then damage to face there. With one 5 attack Patron, 3 attack Patron, and the cruel Taskmaster, he can actually hit Hoi's face for 10 here. I think that's too good to pass up, and with that hand, I feel like he might have to go all in here.
Well, he only has 9 mana available, so he can actually play his entire hand.
Oh, you are correct. Yeah, that's right.
So I think he has to play this just by choice of elimination.
Absolutely. I thought he had the mana to cast all of that, but you are correct.
Now, if he picks up Whirlwind Effect again,
then maybe he actually does have the lethal next turn, but Hoi is still on the draw to win the game. Or is he?
Well, that's not it. And now it's going to be Ostkaka with a chance, too.
Right, and what's so interesting, lethal. Too, is Hoi, he could try to play into Force of Nature number two, because he can't just Hero Power the face. He actually has to Savage Roar the face.
Wow. You think he's going to do it?
Yeah, I think so. I think he's just going to say...
But,
oh, okay.
You know, he's clearing, because he could have saved it, because if he wants to top deck the Force, he could have casted both of the Roars, because sure, the Emperor sure. discounts.
Also, he's worried about the Patreon copies, and the more, the merrier. Oh, that would have been disastrous.
Yeah.
Wait, that's... isn't that still disastrous? It's 3, 6, 8, no. It's going to be 3 off. But if he didn't, that copied Patreon would have been lethal.
Wow.
Yeah. Imagine that. So Hoi using the Savage Roar, saving his behind just for one more turn.
Yep, that's... I mean, can you really wait with this? Just going for the Whirlwind Wars and Command. I think the big question is, do you clear off the Emperor or not? But I don't really think of his cards.
What lethal does he gain by having it versus what you lose? I mean, I feel like you're almost all in at this point, too, if you're Ostkaka.
Right.
But if you want to blink, I wouldn't blame him either. Because if you are out of combo range now by doing this.
Not really, because the Emperor sticks to the board, so that's going to be additional damage.
All right, Ostkaka's out of bullets. Does Hoi draw the card he needs?
No, not yet. Will that keep him safe, though? He can heal for 5 with the lore. He can Hero Power, so he goes up to 9. He does still survive.
Yeah, he survives. And there's a 5-5 body on the board.
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, this game has gone from using all their bullets and using all their knives and close-range weapons to their fists to now they're just spitting on each other in like a defeat of fatigue. Like, they just actually can't kill each other at this point.
Right. But Ostkaka with so many draws, man. There's so many things that Ostkaka can draw. Deathbite would do it.
Deathbite would do it. He just needs any way to amplify his damage a little bit.
Right.
Is he thinking about Savage Roar to kill the final patron?
Or the Warsong Commander.
Or the Warsong Commander.
Clearing the Warsong Commander would keep him safe
from a
gnomish inventor.
It could be. There's a lot of choices with the Savage Roar. Where's it going to go? It looks like he marked the Warsong Commander.
Yeah, I agree with this. It seems like there's not that many things that would...
But one weapon could change it all.
Oh, that's the Gnomish Banner!
Yeah,
so if he didn't clear it...
There are some really tough calls here, but Hoi is trying to do his best. Battle Rage off the top is a huge draw.
3 chances to find an Inner Rage effect or a weapon.
Inner Rage! And that's going to be able to allow him to seal it. Ostkaka takes a first game. Barely.
Yeah, that was a close one. Oh my, so many turns where it's just like, I could have top decked the lethal. Ostkaka could have. Wow, it's just... Doesn't get any closer than that.
Man, what an intense game number one. And that's just the first of the best of 5. Very important, though, that Ostkaka was able to hold based off what he was anticipating. I know a lot of patron players feel like it's very good against Druids. So if the patron didn't win there,
right.
Yeah, he would have been in trouble.
Like, that's a worthy game one. There's so much on the line right now. I hope the entire series is going to be games like this.
Yeah, and, you know, when you go to BlizzCon, you're also not only playing on a big stage in the U.S. and, you know, competing for the World Championships, but it's a lot of money, too.
It is.
You have to be fighting for. So these guys, you know, they don't have the most popular streams. You know, they're not exactly the most ones out there in terms of marketing and just doing the community events. They really pride themselves on their strong play and their good tournament earnings. So this is also really a big deal with what they could potentially earn in a huge tournament.
Yeah, even here, if they go out, they get that. I believe it's $1,250, right. But the first prize is $10,000.
Yeah, for every win from this point on, you double up. You go from $2,500 to $5,000 to $10,000, and it's like, that's a lot.
To
just play some Hearthstone on a weekend. It's not bad.
That's too bad.
Yeah. And with that, we see that Ostkaka does have the Druid remove, and Hoi still has that Hunter and the Paladin decks. Those are the ones that are really interesting to me. Now that the Warriors out of the way, can we just play the Paladin?
Yeah, just go for it. I want to see it. I mean, even in the previous match, I was just waiting for the Paladin. Maybe now is the time.
But how does it interact with the Dragon Priest? That's a big question.
I think it should be fine. Equality is quite powerful against Dragon Priest. Dragon Priest sometimes has a tough time recovering from that because the Dragon Priest doesn't draw that many cards. Usually they got things like Thought Steals and Dragon Priest might run out of resources.
It's a good point. You know, without Circle of Healing, well, it's not the mid-range paladin, first of all, but without the Circle of Healing, you're right. The only way you can mash draw cards is Holy Nova.
Right.
And by doing so, you're very reliant on board position in the first place. Hoi is going with a paladin, the first that we're seeing of its kind today, and it is the Secrets Paladin.
Yep, looks like it.
But don't tell Oskaka.
Nope.
That's right. This deck is really predicated on making sure that you have strong board by a very good curve. On turns 1 through 5, you're hitting minions back to back. And then on turn 6, you drop the Mysterious Challenger, pull every secret from your deck, only one of them actually, pull one of each secret from your deck, and then from there firmly control the tempo of the game.
That's the dream, but sometimes you don't get that kind of draw. Sometimes you just draw all of your secrets into your hand and the Mysterious Challengers are nowhere to be found. It's a little bit like an inconsistent deck for my taste, but it is quite powerful.
Yeah, it suffers from a lot of what, you know, I call the mid-range syndrome in Hearthstone, where you just unfortunately have a very good curve if it works out, but if it doesn't, you're in a really awkward spot a lot of the times. One thing that's also interesting to consider too is that a lot of these paladins have gotten slower over time. They've started, you know, falling away from the Wolf Riders and the Arcane Golems to more slow cards that have big power, like Tyrion and Dr. Boom. I'm leaning towards that. I feel like I haven't seen many aggro Mysterious Challengers in a while.
No, not at all. Wow, that's an incredible hand from Hoi. He's curving out really nicely here, and I would imagine that it's going to be it. He's still having divine favors in there. Ostkaka's hand a little bit slow, getting a Twilight Trick. Sorry, Twilight Whelp, one turn too late. He would have loved to play it on turn one. That Wildfire might do a lot of work, but outside of that, seems a bit slow. He might struggle to keep up with Hoi.
One thing that's really interesting too about the Dragon Priest is that Ysera is, even though it's like a very slow card and it doesn't actually do anything for a while, it does anchor the deck for like Blackwing Corruptor. Because a lot of times if you're holding a lot of the early game dragons to play on curve, like if that was the only dragon he had, well, not only could he play it for value, but Blackwing Corruptor can't get activated, so Dragon Priest, sometimes it's held victim by its own synergies, versus having Ysera sometimes isn't the worst thing, even though ideally you'd like to have more plays.
Yeah, I'm a huge fan of the design overall, because like, normally you feel bad when you have Ysera in your early hand, and it's still not great, but it's at least a little exciting to watch. Ysera, yeah, like we haven't seen him play, so it would be cool to see what he brought to the tournament and how he can pilot those decks. But also Lifeguard, it's always a pleasure to watch Lifeguard play, patrons especially.
Absolutely. The players are almost ready. There was a handshake, and one of them is going to BlizzCon. I'm really excited, as Froda mentioned, really excited lineups. Anti-Hoi lineup, and Hoi is bringing his trusty Druid, Hunter, and Paladin. What do you guys think about it?
We haven't seen the Paladin yet. I'm still waiting to see if it's Mysterious Challenger or the mid-range one.
What if it's Dragon Paladin?
Dragon
knocks
Paladin.
You off your seat right now.
Dude.
Pretty unlikely. Almost as likely as his Murloc Paladin. Actually, it's more likely to be Murloc Paladin than Dragon Paladins, based off the way things go. But I want to see what's going to happen. Specifically, can a non-Warrior player make it to BlizzCon? We've seen it go through the top 40. We've seen a few players do it, but can Hoi be the first to do it without the aid of Garrosh? Thank you very much, Nim, for the introduction. We're going to go into game number one with Druid versus the Warrior one more time between these two players to see who's going to be able to get that first edge in the series.
Yep, that's a fair matchup to start things off with. Let's see what kind of starting hands they end up with. Hoi, no Wildcard, no Innervate just yet in sight.
Nope, even if he had the Innervate, do you feel like he'd play on the Shade that first turn, or would he hold on to it, given that he has more mid-range minions?
It's possible that he would have just went for it. But obviously it's not perfect when you don't have the Wildcrow to follow it up. With a clunky hand, you usually want to save the Innervate and try to find the perfect moment for it.
Oh, Darnassus has Sprint on curve. However, it's a little bit optimistic to assume it'll survive. There's almost there's so many ways for it to be able to get killed. Whether your opponent can buff the Acolyte or buff the Armorsmith, use a weapon, use a removal spell,
slam Cruel Taskmaster, Fiery War Axe, all of those cards to deal with it quite easily. But well, what's the point of holding on to it really?
Nothing really when you want to ramp specifically into some of these mid-range minions. But hesitation does give you the perception that you have options,
And Osaka might consider it. It's like, well, if he waited this long to play Darnassus, maybe he has a Wild Growth.
Right.
And like, maybe if he has Wild Growth, I don't have to account for one of those cards in his hand. He's like, well, that last card you're holding isn't swipe, it has to be a Wild Growth. Like, these kinds of things that are going through the minds of opponents.
I think that the Wild Growth would have come out here over the Aspirant every single time, but it does kind of fake innervate, maybe.
Yeah, that's also too. Well, I think Osaka, he's feeling pretty good. I think coining out the Armorsmith is also one of those things that, speaking of Wild Growth.
Oh, wow, there it is. One turn late. He would have loved to have that last turn. No, he's probably just going to go with the Shade. He could ramp up to the Lotus, but I mean, you don't want to wait with the Shade any longer. Ooh, that spite.
That spite's pretty big, although I suppose he just wants to try to develop some of his card draw. The challenge is that the Acolyte of Pain, this is the turn where the Keeper of the Grove comes down. So you're always afraid of Acolyte just getting no cards.
Yeah, sometimes it's a strategy where you can kind of line up the Acolyte in a way that you drop it when the opponent, Druid, is about to hit 5 mana, because Druid does not want to play a Keeper with 5 mana. There's so many strong minions for turn 5, Azure Drake, Druid of the Claws, that type of thing. So I think he might lean towards the Dreadcursor and Hero Power here over the Acolyte. But I wouldn't hate the Acolyte. I don't think it's a bad play, but just how well the Keeper works out. I think the Dreadcursor is the stronger play.
Yeah, Dreadcursor does put some board presence as well. Helps you answer whatever's coming out next for 4 mana. You know, Shredder plus Quartz, or the Shredder comes out, Dreadcursor might be able to help answer it.
Yep. We can see that the Acolyte looks like it's going to work out better than the Corsair would have, since there's no real good answer to it. And he might be able to slam it next turn.
Now we hit a very awkward scenario where maybe Wild Growth is not get played.
Yeah.
You want to deny the draws from this Acolyte. Drawing is one of the key linchpins to this entire deck. If it's not drawing, it's not doing very much.
Yep, as powerful as Wild Growth can be when you play it on turn 2, here it's just not doing anything at all. He's not finding the time to play it anymore. Whirlwind off the top, he really needs some card draw. He needs some more. He has to slam, so that's an option. But do you really slam here?
The problem with slam is that your follow-up is also pretty interesting in that like you don't kill a minion, but if you use it to kill a minion, you don't draw. And at the same time, you want to be very efficient with your cards. So it is a very interesting position.
Yep, there's some plays here, with, for example, like killing off the Shade with the Fiery Warax, Equipping the Death Spite, playing the Zero Mana Trade Corsair, but that's a bit risky. What if there's a Harrison Jones waiting? What
now? If it goes on your first Death Spite, are you really that sad? I guess it is, because you just don't have that guarantee for card draw.
I mean, if it goes on a double stack Death Spite.
If he Whirlwinds, he hypothetically should be able to clear most minions that come out of that Shredder outside of 4 health minions and Doomsayers.
Right. Doomsayer is not an issue, really.
Okay.
Well, that's interesting.
So he trades into Armorsmith. Fair enough. Although, I'm always worried about making sure I can protect my Armorsmith to get as much health as possible.
That was an interesting play. He really values the... Osaka values the Whirlwind extremely highly, because that was a good moment for the Whirlwind, but he really wanted to hold on there.
Right. In fact, the Whirlwind would have guaranteed a board clear.
Yeah.
And he would have still had Armorsmith?
Yeah, it seemed pretty smooth, but...
Oh, no, it would have died in the Whirlwind. So the Armorsmith would have actually died as well.
Oh, right. If you had, in the Shade, but... Yeah, right.
Well, Micro Machine happens to challenge perfectly with every turn passing. In this case, Lotheb only denies the slam, which is pretty inconvenient because that would have been a great slam plus Fiery Warax opportunity.
Absolutely. The Fiery Warax still strong here. And against the Druid, your win condition is usually the patrons and not the frothing, so no real problem with just playing the frothing here.
All right, well, Hoi does get some pretty good opportunities this turn.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I was going to say, this might be the turn for Wild Growth, because he could also swipe that if he does that, but does the Wild Growth really benefit you anymore?
Not really, because it feels like Dr. Boom's coming down next turn anyways. So having 8 mana doesn't really change much for the next turn. Does it change anything for the following turn outside of put you in potential range of Force of Nature Savage Roar? It's a very unlikely scenario.
Yeah, he doesn't even have one combo piece right now. If he had the combo in his hand, then maybe it would be more tempting to go for the Wild Growth.
Does he feel like he can get away with Sylvanas as well?
I don't know, it seems so weak, because the Frothing is just going to trade for it on the board, and the Fire Warax is going to clean up that.
It's true.
Low step, so if there could be potentially an empty board, Emperor coming from Ostaka. It's actually a tough turn. It doesn't look very complicated, but it is.
Shredder. Well, Shredder's more sticky than Sylvanas in terms of one-for-one body trading.
I like it, considering the Frothing.
Yeah, in fact, you just care about having minions onto the board to help fight for control, so that way Dr. Boom has higher impact.
I think that was the best possible turn he could have made. Waiting with the Wild Growth, he would have to wait another 4 turns, and that's a little bit too much.
Mm-hmm. I think you'd rather have that mana so you can hit more powerful turns as the game goes on. Ostaka picks up Execute, which helps him deal with the board and some of the minions, but does he want to save Execute for later on? I guess he'll evaluate his hand.
He might want to save it for an Ancient of War. This is not really that good of a target for it just yet.
It's true. You do know that he has Ancient of Wars in his deck.
Right. Oh, there's another one, but second. It's still like it only deals 1 damage or 2 damage, depending on what you want to use them.
Yeah. Well, if you part ways with a Whirlwind...
The Whirlwind here is... Well, it only kills 1 of the minions, but it just buffed the Frothing quite a bit.
Well, okay, a stable goal to block, so that way... Fair enough, it kills itself.
Yep.
Assuming a Keeper of the Grove doesn't come out here, he's just going to push for damage.
That swipe also kind of works. Ooh, innervate. So the Wild Crowding last turn looks to be working out all right, because now he can both swipe and play the Sylvanas.
Yeah, and the Unstable Goal was played second, so no matter what you do, it's going to kill the Shredder's minion. Okay.
Yeah. It's going to deal 1 to the minion coming from the Shredder.
Because it's going to collide into it. You have to swipe this, you have to bump it. So all you pray is that it's not a 1 health minion coming out of the Shredder.
Captain Sparrow, though, something would be so bad. Or the 4-1. Okay.
No, that's
pretty bad.
It's okay.
It's pretty bad, but it's okay.
I mean, it's okay because he doesn't have the patrons. But if he had the patrons, it'd be pretty bad.
He's low on cards, so he will be a hero powering quite a bit. So it shouldn't be an issue that the Archon Watchman can only attack after you use your hero power.
Is Ostaka in the lead is Hoi in the lead now because he's actually got some quality minions versus Ostaka's got primarily spells?
Oh yeah, I mean, Ostaka's hand doesn't do anything right now. He has some removal, but that's it. He needs card draw. If he finds something like the Crim Patron, that's going to turn things around. But as it is, it's possible that Ostaka is just going to top deck 2 Inner Rages and not have anything to do in many turns.
Execute on Sylvanas just to try to deal with it preemptively. Also, he's well aware that he could hypothetically die to a combination attack through Force of Nature Savage Roar. And he even kills this as well.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where you can also evaluate, like,
feel a bit less bad.
It's tolerable.
Yes. That's one way to put it.
Very much like, Mysterious Challenger arrives. Now, it's a little bit early, but this card is bonkers. Now, if you don't believe me, just watch in a few turns. However, that said, the thing that's also even more important than Mysterious Challenger itself is the fact that the curve is followed. Ostaka, on the other hand, does have 3 AoEs. And when you AoE enough the Paladin down, it's very hard for Paladin to climb back unless they have that Divine
Favor. It is. Hoi will need the Divine Favor in this matchup.
Right.
One way to win is the Mysterious Challenger. If there's no answer to it and it gets the Avenge buff, it gets up to 10-9 or whatever it is after the Competitive Spirit and the Avenge, that can win the game alone, but if the Mysterious Challenger gets dealt with and this board gets AoE down, he will be down to top decking the Divine Favor.
Right, and the thing is, though, a couple of things to consider. First, Ostaka still doesn't want to take too much damage. I mean, that's a lot of pressure on board. 9, plus the potential of scaling higher with the Secret Keeper. You don't want to be losing a third or maybe more of your health. The second is, how much does he telegraph, right? Like, if he coined Blackwing Corruptors the Shredder, it's like, isn't that a little obvious that he has AoE? So there's a lot of things like maybe he doesn't want to be too defensive, but he doesn't want to be too obvious. I'm not sure exactly what he's going to choose here.
I kind of like the coin Blackwing Corruptor anyway. The Paladin, the way it works is it can't really slow down it.
Okay.
All in over.
Halfway. Well, yeah. It's like, oh, I need to deal with the threat. Oh, you got me. No, he's got more AoE.
Yeah, it does deal with a lot of stuff, and that means that he will be taking way less damage on the next turn. Oh, Redemption. Not very good right now. He might only be running 1.
Actually,
it's possible. So the Mysterious Challenger won't get money.
If Redemption's not too bad, because based off the way things have spawned and died, If he AoEs again with Holy Nova, the Pilot Shredder should return
first.
Oh
yeah, you are correct. So Pilot
and
Shredder.
That's huge.
Yeah, it absolutely is.
Also, it's pretty important that Mysterious Challenger has another minion besides itself. Another minion besides itself.
Yep. Might do some.
Ooh. Here we go. Avenge.
Oh, no, man. Gotta feel.
Yeah.
Feel it for Hawaii a little bit here.
And, you know, the Thalanos is a draw. So that helps him get back, but he's still looking for that divine favor.
Yeah, he sure is.
The thing is, there's only one, and that's something that this Paladin deck is also... deck is also
noble sacrifice, but he won't get it because there's already one up.
Right.
5 HP. He needs to find a way. He needs to find a Shadow of Death. It doesn't even do it, though. No, I think it would not be enough. Death. It doesn't even do it, though. No, I think it would not be enough.
That Paladin's out of the way, the Druid's out of the way, the series is, or sorry, the war is out of the way.
And lock and load. A lot of cool.
Lock and load.
There's a lot of cool. Cards, yeah. But not that many cards that would really like fit in competitive decks, I would say. Unless not the existing ones.
I do believe people tried Bear Trap for a little bit, but. It's just like, you know, and King's Elec also was kind of cool in concept. It's like, well, if you joust and you win, you draw the minion. That's very good for consistency, but you joust and you win, you draw the minion. That's
if you could just they might be in trouble,
but at the same time he can pretty much play whatever minion he draws in the next couple of turns, especially because he's got two innervates. A lot of people look at this and they say, Savitz, I really want a Wild Growth. But is there an argument against it here to try to grab early board?
No, I think you just do it. You're not too worried about that. Just ramping up here, it seems so sweet.
Mm-hmm.
But I wouldn't, I'd absolutely hate that it's something like a Innervate Keeper for the Silence, but still, like getting that out early. And the Ascension of Lore that I mentioned.
That's really big, because now on turn four, when he gets that fifth mana crystal, he can innervate that out, and Druid's in a pretty good spot.
Absolutely.
Hmm.
And Hunter's hand looks a bit reactive at the moment.
Yeah, most of the things are very reactive. Unleash the Hounds is, Ironbeak Owl is, Kill Command is. Of course, the reaction is he low on health?
Yeah. The bow seems to be the only not terrible play here out of the options that I had.
Mad Scientist still being able to peck away and do some work is still significant damage. I mean, that's what makes some of these silence targets really difficult to deal with. Sylvanas, Mad Scientist, they still ultimately do some damage.
Absolutely. Innovating into the lore, draws two cards, let's see what he finds. Imperatorism. And a swipe.
Swipe is pretty big too, considering Snake Trap exists.
And he even has the Innervate Shredder with 6 mana. And that Innervate, he could potentially play both the 4-3 minion and play the swipe. It's quite powerful.
I wonder if Horish is going to play the Snake Trap here and make it seem like he might have Freezing Trap.
He could, yeah.
And then does Oskaka feel the need to like bounce it back? I mean, to be honest, Ancient of Lore is not really that bad of a thing to rebound, but you don't want to give the charge to the bow.
Yeah, like the bow charge is the main thing about this. You don't mind about that, returning the lore to your hand, but the bow getting an extra charge, you definitely have to be a little bit worried about it.
So if he is worried, he might just hold on to this Ancient of Lore attack, swipe, and then put out the Shredder? Or do you think Druid of the Claw is enough of a resistance where you can just bait it out?
No, I think the Druid of the Claw is not what you want to do here. It's a tough situation because you have to kind of try to guess what it is. He probably knows the traps that Hoi is playing. Just dropping the Emperor. Wow, how much damage is that with the Druid of the Claw, or if you charge it?
That is 14 plus 8 is 22.
Plus the swipe hero power.
That's 26. You can't hero power as well. You only can do one of those.
Right. Yeah, that's true. Yep. That's true.
So he'll have 26 damage.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a lot. I mean, he still can't kill him, though. Hoi picks up the Houndmaster, but he has no beast synergy at the moment.
He can unleash and hope that one of those survive for next time. It seems kind of clunky.
He can Owl and Kill Command right now.
It's so bad, though, because the Owl, what does it really do? I mean, silence is the Emperor, but if you kill Commanding it anyway.
It sells on Freezing Trap.
Oh, that's true.
So, like, if you Owl and Kill Command one target, it makes it seem like it really is Freezing Trap, and
nice.
He has to play as if it is Freezing Trap.
It's actually a really small thing, but he can bluff the trap. I think it's important that he Kill Commands that.
Right, and of course he Kill Commands the cheaper minion.
Yeah.
And his hope now is for rushing for damage. Oskaka does have a counter to the board, though. One of the things about pushing for damage with Freezing Trap is that you have to continue to shove on your opponent's health, but Swipe stops that.
Yep. All right, so I will Battlecry completely wasted there, but he needed the beast for the Kill Command. It's kind of okay, I suppose.
Yep. And one thing, too, is that if he can take care of the board and things don't get swiped, he has a clear path to the high main.
That is true.
And he already used one Keep of the Grove on that Mad Scientist, which, by the way, has stayed alive this entire time, dealing 8 damage or so. Not bad.
Is he going to charge?
Yeah. He's going to rebound that and realize that he can go for the face completely.
16 damage in his hand, the minions and the Roar combined. So a 9 on board, Roar with the hero power, additional 7. So he needs 2 more damage from that, though, in order to threaten lethal.
Yeah, he could pick up through, you know, if he just gets Force of Nature, that's more than enough.
He can go Shredder, Wrath the Shredder for the Murloc Blue Kill Warrior.
Yeah, or that's a Flametongue Totem.
Mm-hmm. Easy lethal.
That's really creative stuff. Really creative stuff. Hoi could stop that, though, if he just goes ahead and puts some pressure onto the board. Yep. High main's his best bet by a big margin. That's 2 extra damage.
Yeah.
And that's going to be game number 3 over in Oskaka's book. The Hunter has fallen.
Yep.
Uh-oh, that's going to be a disaster if he can't actually stabilize the series. Oskaka is 1 game away from qualifying for BlizzCon.
The Hunter really struggling here. And Oskaka's lineup seems to be almost assigned to just crush the Hunter and nothing else.
At the same time, though, if you ask Koi what he wanted remaining, I'm pretty sure he wanted this matchup with the Hunter as opposed to playing the Priest, wouldn't you say?
I guess.
I mean, ultimately, I feel like the Priest is still really good at dissecting cards, classes like Hunter with Worm Rest Agents and Valence Chosen.
Yeah, it's quite powerful.
But Hoi does, at the same time, does have a lot of those tempo cards, right? Like Hunter's Mark and really destroy Valence Chosen.
It's definitely a good matchup for the Priest. But both of those are Ostgog are really on the driver's seat here.
Absolutely. And it's going to take a very, very good circumstance for Hoi to be able to come back here, but it's still not impossible.
It's not impossible at all. Right. Sometimes with that Druid and the Hunter both, if you curve out nicely and your opponent maybe struggles a little bit, the Priest has a lot of reactive cards in it still, and if he draws those early on and can't play them, like Shadow over Death in the starting hand, things like that.
Yeah.
And the Priest can absolutely self-destruct.
Yeah. Yeah, it's definitely true. It's just really tough to kind of swallow because, again, this is the decider match to go to BlizzCon, and this is the match that you started off with, and you're up against someone that you respect a lot as a teammate. Both these guys, they haven't been on team for very long with each other. In fact, it was just 2 weeks ago that Na'Vi got announced along with 6-0. Three great European players, all very dominant on ladder, and even through qualifier processes. But unfortunately, only one can go through. It feels a little unfair, but at the same time, this is kind of what you need to do in order to continue your journey through the road to BlizzCon.
Oh, yeah, the snow teammates here right now. It's just like an unfortunate draw for them, but at least one of them is going to be going through. So maybe there's a little bit of, you're going to feel a little bit better. Even though losing is horrible, you're going to feel a little bit better knowing that your teammate at least made it.
All right, well, Hoi's going to put his faith in nature and hopefully can even up this series, but Ostgog feels like he's in a pretty good spot. Twilight Whelp doesn't gain any dragon buffs, but that is a low curve Priest, which is what you're looking for early on.
An excellent hand. Even he kind of needs another dragon so that he could play the Twilight Help. The Wild Pyro with the coin and the shield is an excellent way to deal with a Shade of Naxxramas.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't really, I don't know if you can keep both the Wild Pyro Power Shield and the Twilight Whelp Worm Restoration. I think he needs to like choose a path here, and I think he's going to go with the dragon.
It's true, although he could keep the Twilight Whelp to buff the Worm Rest Agent and then play Wild Pyromancer, and then use those two minions for board control.
Mm-hmm. Then he won't have the coin. If he goes down one coin into Worm Restoration, then he will no longer be able to deal with the Shade.
That's true. But by keeping the Twilight Whelp, then he has the opportunity to draw into like Twilight Guardian and have that be live too, while still having board control early on.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess it depends what his opponent's going to be able to be doing as well in the following turns.
Keeps all four. Wow, and Ostgog really hoping to get that extra additional dragon so that he can play the 12 on well upon the turn one. Does not find it.
That's true. Coin Pyromancer. The most board control early on, most damage. Forces Hoi to Wrath it or choose to Wild Growth and Ramp.
Yep.
Not to mention that this challenge is Darnassus Aspirin. It's very smart.
Oh yeah, we saw this exact same situation in one of the earlier Ostgog's matches where he chose to go for the Wild Pyromancer first, and it makes a lot of sense.
Right. Valence Chosen, a pretty good draw too, just to continue to plant the board. Hoi only has the Shade of Naxxramas this turn.
If nothing for next turn. Oh my, he really needs to find something that he can play on this turn four.
Dark Cultist as well.
Yep.
Which do you like better? Dark Cultist is a pile of stats. I mean, it's actually more stats than Valence Chosen.
I wouldn't even hesitate. I would just drop the Cultist here. It seems like it's so powerful to get out. And Hoi already struggling to get a full clear on the board.
It's true. I mean, the only thing that Valence Chosen really gives you is the ability to do more damage this turn.
Yeah, it makes the Keeper kind of good, though.
That's true. It's just two targets that you want to silence.
Right. And he plays the Cultist. Here we go, and Hoi, this is an important draw for him.
Yeah, if you can.
Well, I guess.
Yeah, it kills off the Worm Rest Agent and the Pyromancer.
It's not good, but I think the board is just going to get too bad for him if he doesn't play it here.
The Priest can just pick up so many good trades. Pyromancer allows him to get really good sweeps. Yeah, you know, desperate times call for desperate measures. You're not happy about it, but you gotta live with it. And Ostgog is the one who is going to need to find something to do. The Valence Chosen allows him to kill this pretty effectively. He's going to want to hold on to Twilight Whelp.
Starting with the shield, hoping to pick up something else. Shrinkmeister.
Not bad.
Okay.
There is value to holding on to the Shrinkmeister, though.
There is, yeah, because he does play those Godwild Shadow Priests, for example.
Mm-hmm. But there's still none of them in sight.
Nope.
And the Shrinkmeister, if it comes down now, is 3 damage onto the board, and then Blackwing Corruptor plus the Shrinkmeister should be able to contest whatever comes out next.
And this is really in line with the way that Ostgaka has been playing this matchup. He likes to put a lot of pressure early on, not holding on to too many of his cards for any sort of weird combos. Like coining out the Wildfire early on, not saving it to try burn anything down. Oh, and there's the Cabal. But it would have been a long time off still. He would have had to wait a long time to actually utilize it with the Shrinkmeister.
So the Sylvanas is basically saying you need to kill off your board right now. But then if he kills off his board, what's he going to Blackwing Corruptor? The face and just be aggressive?
Yeah, I guess. There's not really any other options.
It's like you said, this Priest deck is so reliant on making sure that the board keeps getting snowballed into the tempo of the player controlling it, that you're forced to do these maneuvers. But we've also seen the exact opposite where Drew is like, okay, I handle your aggression, and then win. Like, Tice was in this situation too, where he could just remove.
The late game seems to favor the Druid. I mean, yes, Dragon Priest does have that Ysera. Ysera is a card that Druid really struggles to deal with, because Mulch is not a card that's in the Druid list that we are seeing here. So with that 4-12, drawing those stream cards, it can win the game in late game. But generally, the Druid is going to outdraw the Priest.
Well, Hoi does have the Ancient of Lore, but he also can try to remove. Ancient of Lore does act as a body that the Priest will have to deal with, but I guess he's worried about how much damage he could take, too.
Yeah, but I like the Lore here a lot. If he went for something like Swipe, there's nothing more that he can do this time. There's kind of already a trade that's likely to happen. Also, getting those extra cards makes the Emperor even better for the following turn.
Agreed. Well, now Ostgaka's in a pretty interesting situation here. A lot of people feel like, well, you know, I want to be able to fight for the board and be making sure that I can always have something really firm on it. But at the same time, things like Shadow or Death kind of leads into, like, is that all he does that turn?
It's really weak. I mean, he could go for Valence Chosen, but do you want to do that when you know that your opponent has Big Game Hunter in his deck?
Right.
You're committing so hard. We know that playing the Valence Chosen on the Corruptor would be just fine in this situation, looking at the hands. But if you lost Kaka, you probably don't want to put so many eggs in one basket.
Right, you just kind of just hit and then not actually buff it at all. Which feels counterintuitive, because generally speaking, you know, rules in card games, the more the person uses more mana generally is an advantage. It's a hard decision to make.
It really is. Even the Shadow War Death is not obvious, because there could be an Ancient of War coming up afterwards.
Right, which you know are in Hoi's deck.
Oh, he's gonna go for it.
Okay.
Oh man, big plays.
Plays for days. 7-8, going to the face, and puts potential lethal with the Holy Nova. Although it's still very iffy, Druid most likely will heal, armor up and get out of that range.
Hoi can kill it with either, Force of Nature.
Wrath,
I think that's it, yeah.
Force of Nature Wrath seems reasonable. You have a decent amount of cards.
Or he could also Wrath for one, Wrath for three, and then swipe if he wants to cycle and keep both of his forces. But it seems a bit weird to be holding on to two Force of Natures. Like, you don't really need it more than one.
Yeah, I like using a Force of Nature. It's clunky to use as the turns go on.
Yeah, it really is.
Unless you drop Emperor Thorazin, which is very optimistic.
Ostgaka not going to be too sad to see this trade happen. Two cards for two cards, and he had a what looked like a bad turn last turn turned out to work quite all right. He keeps the initiative.
Ugh, that's not what he needed. No. Although Kamal Shadow Priest is still board presence, but looks like he is getting hit by the Eternal Priest problem, which is finishing the game.
Yeah.
Priest is really good at starting fights, he's just never good at ending them.
Playing the 6 mana Chilwind Yeti. Feels bad, man.
Yeah, it's definitely not what you want, especially when your opponent drops an Emperor Thorazin with a pretty scary hand.
Yep.
Like, a scary hand size, excuse me. The hand itself is nothing too special, but it's what it could represent.
Yep. What Ostgaka has going for him is that Hoi is already down to 11, and he's going to be able to hit for another 4 here, so he will be able to put Hoya down to 7.
True that. This is his second Shadow War death, though.
It is.
And if an Ancient of War gets drawn, it's a brand new game.
Yeah, it is. Then at that point, Ostkaka will have to get his Vol'jin.
But what else is the alternative? Holy Nova to kill the Thorzin? No,
no
way.
He has to do this.
You have to go for it and cross your fingers that there's no Ancient of War.
Absolutely. I mean, with those cards in his hand, he's even going to play them with Twilight Vol'jin.
Yeah, I'm down.
It's not going to do anything. It's going to get swiped. But I still kind of approve, because with that hand, what else can you do?
BGH a little late to the party.
Yep.
He RSVP'd as a maybe on Facebook, but got there too late. And now the swipe double clear here is definitely enough. Would you Wrath at all just to draw another? Actually, no, you can play the Pyre Shredder.
Mm-hmm.
Thorzin's so good.
What's the interaction here? Maybe he swipes that first. If he swipes the Cabal Shadow Priest first and then the Dark Cultist, does it actually
No,
die?
It should be fine. I think it's because you kill it simultaneously, it doesn't actually buff.
Right.
I think there used to be
a bug earlier on where the main target damage happened first, where you sometimes like a...
Right.
Like it used to... If you casted it on an Imp Gang boss, it would
kill the,
it
one,
would
one.
Kill the one one. Yeah.
Because it triggers the four,
yeah,
damage,
the four
first,
damage first, and then the one damage. So if this was still the case, it would have buffed that other minion, but that bug has been fixed, so those two swipes going to get Hoya the full clear.
This is one of the worst feelings in the world. You're so close, but 7 health feels like 70 health.
Yeah, and Priest is not good at closing out games.
It's like he's like, I wish this was Mind Blast.
No. Or Ragnaros, but I don't think he put that in his dragon deck. No way. He needs to top deck the Ysera. Maybe get Awakens, that would do it. Wow.
Wrathing for 1 to draw a card.
Yeah.
And he's Wrathing his Big Game Hunter so that Holy Nova doesn't destroy him. I like
That's
it.
That's really smart.
Draws
like
Lothep off the top. This is a very good situation for Hoy to turn it around.
Twilight Guardian, no.
Yeah, but it doesn't have to even taunt. It
doesn't do anything. Yeah, he played the Whelp earlier. It didn't do anything, but that's just not helpful. He needed to use Hera badly.
Now is also scenario where Hoy gets Savage Roar off the top, and that's game. A 3-turn reverse.
What do you think about Cleric and healing the Big Game Hunter?
Into...
Trying to
like
desperately. Yeah, I mean, just play the Cleric and hope to find something nice. Maybe a Corruptor or...
That gives you 7 mana. That definitely gives you some room for plays.
Oh, he's still doing it.
I think, you know, Desperate Times...
All right.
Calls for desperate measures.
I like it.
All right, well... Hoy has 13 damage, just needs a little bit more. Savage Roar is ripped!
That is going to do it.
That is a tied series, and we're going to game number 5 to determine who is going to BlizzCon.
Oh man, I'm getting excited for the 5th game. There's so much on the line here.
Unbelievable turnaround. Hoy just breathing a huge sigh of relief, because he knew, based off that start with Priest curving out very aggressively, he got the Blackwing Corruptor on turn 5, and you know he was struggling a little bit. He hit the Savage Roar when he needed a drop on turn 5 himself. It was not looking very good for Drew.
Not at all, but it worked out in the end. And now we're going to see if the Priest is that good against Hunter, or how good is it? Because I think that it's quite...